Sisters, elders, ulama, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. First and foremost, I start by thanking the organizers for inviting me. I'm very humbled. The names on the poster for this event are without doubt great ulama, and I'm simply a student. So to have my name next to their names is quite humbling. And I secondly must say and give my apologies for my late arrival. Aside from teaching this weekend, the train service from Manchester to Huddersfield was really hectic. I wasn't expecting the football to cram me in like a sardine on the train. So forgive me. I am extremely tired and I'm only on two cylinders today, so bear with me, and I hope that this brief discourse can shed some light into this issue of Karbala. Today, I haven't come here to reiterate history. I haven't come here to give you an insight and to talk about those aspects of Karbala in its chronological order, which you have heard before countless of times, no doubt. Today, for the benefit of the youth especially, I have come because I want to investigate certain facets of Karbala in a new light. And I want to bring that investigation and apply it to our day and our times. Because in order to know where we are going, as an ummah, we must know where we have been. So with your ijazah, with your permission, I humbly wish to commence, inshallah, Aziz. Alhamdulillah nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. قال الله عز وجل في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد ومن جاهد فإنما يجاهد لنفسه صدق الله العظيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وسلم عليه. All praise is for Allah Azza wa Jal, who created this entire universe in that perfect order, in that perfect composition. And all praises to Him whose power is such and whose authority is supreme that every facet of this universe could not sustain in existence if it were not for Him. And all praises for Him who bestowed upon us That Rasul, who is the greatest of all Rasuls, who bestowed upon us that book, which is the greatest of all books, who bestowed upon us those Ahlul Bayt, who are the greatest from amongst all the Ahlul Bayt, and who bestowed upon us those Awliya, who are the greatest from amongst all of the Awliya. And all praises to Him, whom even though this universe is created in the order that it is created in, all praises to Him, that those who are the beloved of Him, this universe submits to their will. Today we've come to talk about Karbala. And Karbala is one of those momentous occasions in history that even non-Muslim academics write about this occasion in history. And even non-Muslim individuals talk about this occasion in history, and they all remark at the greatness, the bravery, and the courage of Imam Hussein radiallahu an, and his beloved family radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Even the likes of Nelson Mandela take and observe the character of Imam Hussein radiallahu an and take inspiration from his character. This is his character. And I don't want to talk about all of the events pertaining to Karbala. Instead, I want to talk about certain aspects, and I want us to look into this day and age to seek its application. Because as I started with, we must know where we have been in order to know where we have where we are going. Because whilst Yazid, according to Ibn Kathir, died as a result of a monkey bite, his Yazidiyat lives on today. That Yazidiyat, that frame of mind, exists today. So we must look at the circumstances of that time, and we must seek to find lessons from it. I wish to start with a verse of the Quran that you all read in your namaz, you all read in your salah, in Surah Al-Fatiha. And Allah educates us, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Allah educates us, O Allah, when we stand in your salah, we seek your guidance to the path of those whom are guided, whom you have favored. But this translation of this ayat is somewhat absent of a certain reality. You see, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. What is صِرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ? Yes, it is the straight path, or it is the middle way, as some have commentated. But actually, an understanding of this verse which I prefer, and which I wish to share today, is that صِرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ is the path of stability. The path of? Oh, come on. I know Sunnis, when they're waiting for langar, is somewhat a tragic occasion. And I know you're thinking, is he white? Does he bite? But I assure you, I do not. Now let's all get this, you know, let's get the energy moving a little bit. The path of stability. So Allah tests His beloved people by putting upon them trials. And no one through this life is expected to have an easy life. You will be tested, but it is your response to that test which will determine your maqam. But let us look at the character in light of this understanding of this verse. Let us look then at the character of Imam Hussein radiallahu an and Yazid. You see, people say to me, as you may well be aware, and I'm sure that you are, regarding Yazid, there are two positions. There is sukut, which is silence as to his iman. His fisq, his sinful nature, is transmitted en masse by tawatir. But his Nare Takbir, Nare Risalat, his fisq is mass transmitted, but his iman, some people like Imam Ahmed bin Hanbal called him a kafir. People like Imam Taftazani sent lanat upon him. However, other ulama have remained silent. And I take the view of silence. And that's not because I don't believe he is a kafir. That is because why waste time cursing someone? You're cursing them worse than their punishment. Why waste your breath cursing someone when you could spend your time and energy praising Imam Hussein radiallahu anhu? So we read this verse of Surah Al-Fatiha. Let us look then at the example of Imam Hussein radiallahu anhu. He went from Makkah and he traveled and he was a person of peace, he was a person of mercy. But Ibn Ziyad would not accept this from him. Even when he sent his conditions, his terms, to come to a peaceful solution to the situation where they were near the river Euphrates on the sands of Karbala, Ibn Ziyad would not accept these conditions. And he instructed Amr bin Saad, you must not accept these conditions. But further to that, I want you to massacre him. I want you to kill his family. And then when a'udhu billah, I want you to cut off his head and with the horses of your army, ride over his body such that his flesh separates from his bones when a'udhu billah. But how many people did Ibn Ziyad send to deal with Imam Hussein? Imam Hussein did not have an army. Imam Hussein did not have a huge force. It was merely a band of people who loved each other for the sake of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. 70 or so people, his family members, his children, his women. But how many people under the instruction of Yazid did Ibn Ziyad send? 4,000 people he sent to destroy Imam Hussein. Why? Because when we look at the character of Yazid, he was a very insecure person. He was nervous, he was fearful that Imam Hussein had started a movement which would see him stripped of his power. And so he sent this huge force to crush Imam Hussein. Yet look at Imam Hussein with his family, with his beloved people, his close allies and friends. He stood against this tyrant. So when we say Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim, you say that you can identify those people who demonstrate stability in times of crisis and tribulation. Imam Hussein, with his courage and with his bravery, faced an army of 4,000 people with a mere army of 70 or so people. Is this stability? Therefore, who is on the haq? It is not even an issue as to who is on the haq. But we have those awful individuals in this day and age who dare say Yazid rahmatul alayh, who dare say Yazid radiallahu anhu. So look at this. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam educates us in hadith, Husayni minhu wa ana min Husayn. Husayn is from me and I am from Husayn. And what a beautiful hadith this is, because when we look at the character of Husayn radiallahu anhu, we find many prophetic traits within him, inherited from his noble father, the lion of Allah azza wa jal, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, karamallahu wajhul kareem. And look at his mercy. Allah describes the mercy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi in the Quran. It's an oft-recited verse, you all know this verse. And Allah tells us, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. That He is a mercy to all of the worlds. But where did Imam Hussein demonstrate this mercy which made him from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He was facing the army on that day. He faced them, he mounted a camel, and when he addressed the army, look at what he said to them. He did not say, we will fight you, we will spill your blood. He reminded them, who am I? Who are these people I stand before you with? I remind you of this because if you murder me, if you murder my family, you will find your homes in Jahannam. And the mercy inside of me urges me to remind you so that you rethink and that you leave. And he addressed those people. He said that I am the last grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam alive today on this earth. And I have not come here of my own accord. I was called to Kufa by the people of Kufa on the premise that they would support me. I came here for them. What have I done to you? Look at this address. I am the last of the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I am his last grandson on this earth sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Think about who you are facing. And this is why Hur, who was one of the commanders of the opposing army, it was narrated that after the speech, you could see him gradually moving across the battlefield. And eventually he joined the army of Imam Hussein. Because this is the impact of the Ahlul Bayt. The fada'il of the Ahlul Bayt cannot be extolled enough. I have led you two things the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrates in a beautiful sahih hadith. In fact, this hadith is more authentic in its sanad than the hadith which I will quote to you also. There are two things I have left with you, the Quran and the Ahlul Bayt. This is more authentic as a narration than I have left you the Quran and the Sunnah. But we don't find a conflict, as we know the Sunnah is with Ahlul Bayt. Such is the rank of Ahlul Bayt that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he talks about them, he explains to us how for their amal on Yawm al-Qiyamah, because of the blood within them, they will be forgiven. You have to recall, who is it that you are thinking of when you think of Ahlul Bayt? You are not thinking of ordinary individuals. You are thinking of those individuals who in their veins flows the blood of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is their maqam. This is why this event in history was so tragic. And I read to you the verse in my khutbah, وَمَنْ جَاهَدَ فَإِنَّمَا يُجَاهِدُ لِنَفْسِهِ. We live in a day and an age today where Muslim youth, they struggle with the crisis of identity and they sacrifice themselves, they sacrifice their identity for petty things. I will not read salah. Why? Because the gora catch me with my feet in the sink inside the school toilets. I will not read salah. Why? Because I have college. I will not pray. I know Muslims who during exam time they came to me and they say, can I not fast during Ramadan because it makes me tired for my exams? They were willing to sacrifice the fast of Ramadan to pursue the dunya. We have an identity crisis in this day and age. But what did Imam Hussein stand for on that day? You talk about tasawwuf. You sit there with your prayer beads, your bugrees. But who is the living demonstration of tasawwuf? Who embodied the principles of tasawwuf more than Imam Hussein radiallahu anhu? He could have taught the deen. He could have separated himself. He could have went home. He could have never have made a fuss. He could have opened a madrasa and he could have taught. No problem. He could have educated. But no. We know that knowledge is not there for its acquisition. You are not there to hoard your ilm. Allah refers to these people in the Quran who hoard their ilm, who build their CV for their marketability, but there is no reality to that knowledge. He calls them donkeys. These people are donkeys. If you're talking about ilm and the hoarding of ilm, is there anyone alive today who is more knowledgeable than shaitan? There is an example of someone of knowledge. So Imam Hussein, what does he demonstrate? It is not about what you know in your mind. It is not about what you have memorized in your books. It is about what you apply upon yourself. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was described by Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu anha that he was the walking Quran. He embodied the nature, the essence of the Quran in his character, in his teachings, in his very essence. He was the Quran. Look at Imam Hussein radiallahu anhu. All of that knowledge he had learned, all of that knowledge he had inherited, and he embodied it. And because of that absolute embodiment and absolute application of that knowledge, he knew that when Yazid, that tyrant, took to power, he could not stay silent. He had to step forward and he had to vocalize and defend the haq. And what was he defending? He did not sacrifice and watch his entire family die around him so that thousands of years later, Muslims remember him by reciting khatam on a food. He did not give his family for that purpose. He gave his family for one thing, and that is your identity as Muslimin. Yet in this day and age, we can't even hold on to that. The verse I read to you from Surah Al-Ankabut refers to jihad against yourselves. How many of you perform jihad against yourselves? How many of you struggle against yourselves in your day-to-day life? What challenge can you ever face in your life that will compare to that of Imam Hussein radiallahu anhu? He was holding his honorable, noble, beloved son, Abdullah bin Hussein, in his arms. He was sat outside of his tent when an arrow came from the army of Ibn Ziyad and it pierced his son in the throat and killed his child. How many of you could hold your child in your arms and watch him or her die and hold firm to your deen? Yet Imam Hussein, he did not back away, he did not back down. He demonstrated the definition of courage, and he asked Allah to curse those people who had killed his son. And his sister Zainab radiallahu anha, Imam Bukhari narrates hadith pertaining to the impermissibility of making dua for death. Oh Allah, take my life. How impermissible this dua is. But Hazrat Zainab radiallahu anha, she was opening her heart to Hazrat Imam Hussein radiallahu anha. And look at this, she said to him, oh Imam Hussein, how I would have preferred to die before I had to see this day come. And what did Imam Hussein say back? Did he cry? Did he wail? Did he mourn? Did he complain to Allah at the situation he was in? No. Imam Hussein radiallahu anh, he reminded her of a simple fact of life. He said, Ali radiallahu anh, karamallahu wajhahu kareem, was greater than I, yet he had to die. Fatima Zahra radiallahu anha was greater than I, yet she had to die. My brother, Imam Hassan radiallahu anh, he was greater than I, yet he had to die. We both eventually have to die. And he reminded her that everyone will eventually taste death. But what is the lesson within this? Because there is a lesson in this. And this is one of the lessons I wish to draw forward for you today. The point he was making is, how do you want to die? Shall we flee? Run away? As if we are cowards and die in that way? Or do we stand and die defending the haqq and the deen of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What is the lesson in that for you today? How do you want to die? Because you will all die. This is a very personal example from my life I will now bring to you. But I do this because I see many young people in this room today who are listening to these stories, these riwayat, but they don't go past their ears. And I appeal, I open myself to you right now, and I tell you that when I was 14 years old, some of you in this room are 14, some of you in this room are less than 14, older than 14, I was 14 years old and my older brother at 19 passed away. Did he expect to die at 19? Do any of you in this room expect to die right here today? But the question is not, do you expect to die? The question is, are you ready to die? Are any of you in this room ready to die today? Are any of you in this room prepared to greet the angel of death today? Imam Hussein radiallahu an demonstrated what tawakkul, what dependence and reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. He never faltered. He never feared. Even to the last moments, he was surrounded by 10 people at the river Euphrates. And he fought them. And no one who faced him could defeat him. Why? Because his father was the lion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he inherited that. His father only had children who were lions of Allah azza wa jalla. And this is why the bloodline of Imam Hussein, his nephews, when they went out to fight, these people could not kill him. Facing him at the front, they could only kill him from behind, because you can only kill a lion from behind. This is their maqam. And 10 people surrounded him, but they did not want to strike that final blow. Until the commander of the army instructed that, and himself commanded it and made the first move to do so. And look at this, even after his honorable body had been slaughtered, his head was cut off. What do we find? Such was his maqam, that as his head was paraded through the streets to the pleasure of the people, his lips were moving and they were reciting the Quran. Why? What is the significance of that? Because the thing the ethics, the morality, and the lessons that Imam Hussein gave his life for were not just for his time, during his life, but they were there, his lessons, his missions, what he stood for, what he died for, were there and will be remembered even after his life. Because you cannot kill those whom die in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We must look into ourselves. I didn't want to go through the history again, because I want you to realize that there is nothing in your lives that will ever compare to what Imam Hussein radiallahu anh went through. But what do we find? Every step of the way, sabr, 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 sabr. Patience upon patience upon patience. Mercy upon mercy upon mercy. Such was his maqam. And is it surprising why the Prophet ﷺ says, I am from Hussein and Hussein is from me? Are you really that surprised? This is Imam Hussein. And that is the lesson. We talk about the heroes of World War I and World War II, and rightly so. We talk about the heroes of the past wars who went out to fight. Why? Because they were fighting for principles and ideas which we enjoy today because they sacrificed themselves. But these things are restricted to the dunya. Because of Imam Hussein's sacrifice, you are all still saying today, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is because of that sacrifice that you are the people of Iman today. And therefore I urge you, look into these lessons, apply them in your life, strive against yourself, have patience, have mercy, because there is nothing in your life that will ever compare to a fraction of the tragedy and of the destruction that came down upon Imam Hussein. So much so that when the Prophet ﷺ knew of this event coming, he cried when he made the dua, but he did not say, Oh Allah, free him from this, free him from this. He raised his hands. Look at this, in this day and age, we get it back. We get all of these problems in our life and we seek ta'weez to fix it. We seek these remedies because we can't tolerate an upset in our lives. But look at the Prophet ﷺ, what he says regarding his grandson, and I will finish upon this. He did not raise his hands and say, Oh Allah, spare him. Oh Allah, free him from this fate. He could have done that, but no. He raised his hands and said, Oh Allah, grant him patience. May Allah accept these small words, and I pray that they are a benefit to you. Forgive me, I am only on two cylinders today. I'm very tired, I'm exhausted. But it's a great honor to be before you, and I thank you once again. Alhamdulillah. Barakallahu feekum wa jazakallahu khairan. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu